Extension reports, promo, burning up on beef, 30 seconds.
Price of beef?
Well, there's no question what beef prices are higher in our current dollars now than they have in the past.
Which affects our meals at home.
We do hear a few complaints about this, but they do buy the hamburgers because this is one food that they can stretch, you know.
And it's affecting our meals away from home, too.
If there's any one challenge right now in the fast food industry, it's your beef prices.
Watch when Extension reports on boning up on beef.
Out perspective, extension reports, boning up on beef. Play date 3/26/79.
Beef is a status symbol.
Yes, I think it is. It's you know, it's something that we all enjoy. It's the big mover as far as the meats are concerned.
For beef, my when I go out to eat, I usually pick on a ribeye.
Prime rib is, I suppose, prime rib's my favorite.
You know, if we were just going to be home, we'd have meatloaf. But if we were going to have company, hamburger used to be, you know, a non-company dish.
I like hamburger. I think we all like hamburger. It's good meat. It's beef also, you know.
Yes, I think most of us are sold on beef. And when the price goes up at the meat market, as consumers, we may squirm a little.
I asked one of the meat fellows yesterday exactly, you know, are people saying, I'm not going to buy that, that's too expensive? And he said, no. He said, I think what we're seeing is that they recognize that all prices have gone up, and they're willing to pay out a little more of that income for food, and particularly for meat. Meat is still a good buy. And most of them feel like, many of them have two incomes, and many of them feel like they can afford meat today, or beef particularly. And so they're buying it.
And what kind of prices have we been paying?
Retail beef prices last year, in current dollars, 1978 averaged about $1.82 per pound based on USDA data. And in 1973 dollars, it was $1.42 per pound. But much of that increase, in fact, essentially all of the increase, is accounted for by just the general price inflation that we've had in the economy. If we adjust beef prices for the rise in consumer in the consumer price index, 1978 retail prices of beef were actually lower than they were in 1973, at about 93 cents a pound, compared with about $1.07 in 1973.
Gene Plager, who's been in the cattle feeding business for 38 years, says 1973 was when the bottom dropped out of the market for the feeder.
In summer of 73, well, it was real good, and then long come August, it's when we had the freeze put on the price of cattle, and then when that was lifted, the cattle prices just started dropping from then on.
Well, beef prices were particularly low in 1976, 1977, and even in 1978, in relation to the kind of price increases we had seen on all food products. Now, with the further price rises on beef in the early weeks of 1979, this has changed a bit, and as of January, the index of beef and veal prices at that point was slightly higher than the index of all retail food prices.
Higher? Plager says it depends on what you compare it with.
Well, of course, maybe I'm a little biased, but I think that the price is in line, because when you compare it to other things, I was in Grinnell Friday to sale and sitting in the restaurant, and they had these little candy bars that used to sell for a penny, and they were 10 cents a piece now. And the old nickel candle bar was a quarter, and with the weight being a lot less than it used to be. And so when you compare things like that, or you compare the price of what just a few years ago we paid for a car and the cars today.
Actually, I've heard more complaints about lettuce being a dollar a head than I have any meat prices.
Of course, there's another way to look at the comparative price of beef. Compare it on the basis of what our wages will buy now compared to a few years ago.
In 1972, an hour's earnings of a manufacturing worker would purchase about 2.6 pounds of round steak. In 1978, it would actually purchase more than that, 3.1 pounds. And even as we go into the early weeks of 1979, it would still show an increase over the 1972 level, about nearly 3 pounds of round steak could be purchased with this 1 hour's earnings. We have a similar picture on ground beef or hamburger for the 1972 and 1978 periods. In 1972, this hour's earnings would buy roughly 5.1 pounds, or a little over 5 pounds of ground beef. And in 1978, this had actually increased to something over a little over 5.5 pounds, about 5.6 pounds, with an hour's earnings. Further price increases on ground beef, particularly in the early weeks of 1979, this comparison now shows that the average manufacturing worker could buy about 4.7 pounds of ground beef compared with their, or from an hour's earnings.
One reason prices are high now is that consumers do have a great feeling that they want to consume beef, both in the choice and prime and good, and in the hamburger. We are somewhat a hamburger society. But in addition, beef is a status symbol. Beef, more than any other food, has conveys prestige, and consumers reluctantly reduce their consumption. That's one reason the fluctuations in supply bring rather sharp changes in price.
And those fluctuations, Breimeyer says, are primarily due to the beef cycle.
Beef, more than any other farm commodity, is subject to what we call cycles. The supply and price of beef has gone through these long cycles for a long time. A few years ago, we were in the oversupply phase, oversupply from a farmer's standpoint, with lots of beef on the market and the price of beef and of cattle down. About a year or so ago, farmers found themselves pinched and discouraged, and they began to sell off their breeding stock, and so now we're on the declining phase of the beef supply.
I think it happens when it starts hurting that the cows are not giving them a return where they're making some money, and so they start culling. And
during this time when the cows are being sold, we have lots of beef. During the time when cows are being held back, we are somewhat short of beef, and we're in this phase now.
It takes a while to start building back up again, and so then you go through a period of when the numbers are down, because you can't change the cow cycle overnight. It takes 3 to 4 years to change it.
Our peak beef supply in this country was in 1976, and it's dropped each year since then. And it is almost surely going to drop further during the next couple of years.
Oh, I think so, yes. I think we'll see right now that we don't have the numbers of fat cattle coming through the auctions, and also if you watch your terminal markets, they're down on numbers.
And Albert should have a pretty good feel for the market, as he runs a lot of cattle through his sale barn. We asked what he predicted for the future.
Well, my prediction would be a guess. I don't think anyone can predict what's going to happen in the beef business. The numbers are down. Our imports last year was like 6 million pounds, 6 million ton of what was allowed to be imported into the United States. To me, that says all over the world our beef numbers are down. So my prediction, which would be just a guess, like I say, would be that we're in for some high prices in the beef for a while yet. Good prices for the farmer.
Of course, the farmer doesn't get all the income on beef, just a little over half. He has to share it with others in the beef business, others like Lauren Garrels, a locker operator. He was at Albert's sale the same day we were, competing with buyers from big packing firms.
Definitely I do that, because they set the market, and the market is so I have to pay just as much as what they pay. I buy them, and they're slaughtered within 24 hours after I buy them. I have a building out in the edge of town that I do all my slaughtering in. And my son, he does the slaughtering. They're cooled out there, and then they're hung down here from 9 to 14 days before they are processed. Usually people come in here, they buy a whole side at one time. When you can buy a side of beef and the whole thing, the steaks, roast, and hamburger cost you the same price as an individual pound of hamburger meat, beef is still a terrific value.
Well, it depends on, first of all, the price, the cutting, wrapping charges, the convenience of having a freezer, that's rather important. And of course, if you want to gamble on the market changes, why, hopefully you can put a side of beef in your freezer at a lower price than it might be, say, 4 to 6 months later.
Say you buy a whole beef. How much of that is edible meat?
Well, to begin with, if you start with a 1,000-pound steer, you're going to end up with somewhere near 600 pounds of carcass beef. Now, if you reduce that carcass beef to retail cuts, you're now down to somewhere in the neighborhood of 400 pounds, perhaps just a little bit more, 400, 425. This, in turn, however, would still have to be reduced because of the bone that is present in some of these, but not all, of the retail cuts. So probably by the time we get through to boneless meat, ready to be cooked, we're in the neighborhood of 300, 350 pounds, perhaps, out of that 1,000-pound animal. And, of course, a lot of this depends on also how fat the animal is. The better the yield grade, that is, an animal that would, beef animal that would be in the one or two yield grades, of course, would give you more edible meat than would one of the three and four yield grade.
Russ says you may be ahead, money-wise, to watch for good buys on pieces, like a chuck. Then carve a broilable steak or two from the eye muscle in it.
It's the most tender, well, I guess maybe the second most tender, next to the tenderloin, part of the animal. And that runs all the way from the chuck in the front quarter clear through to the sirloin in the hind quarter. Now, as we get up into the chuck, this muscle becomes fairly small, but we can take a chuck blade roast, cut out the eye of the chuck blade, which is essentially the same as the rib eye steak, or Spencer steak, as it's sometimes called, and we can take that out of a chuck roast. And chuck roasts quite often are not very popular in summer, so they tend to sell for a lower price. And use this as a steak for broiling, grilling, while we would use the remainder of the chuck, of that particular chuck blade roast, as a pot roast, and probably we'd have a few bones left over to make some good homemade beef soup.
How about boning out that chuck and grinding it for hamburger?
I guess I don't really feel that there's much to save by grinding your own. Generally, the hamburger one finds is a mixture of beef from older animals, from cows, principally mixed with some of the fatter meat from the choice grade carcasses. This combination then is usually adjusted, and by the way, the optimum quality hamburger seems to be about 20% fat. This mixture that we have here quite often can be produced more economically to someone who has access to large supplies of both ingredients than would the individual who would have to depend on buying something like a chuck roast to grind for a hamburger.
More on the beef story, and particularly hamburger, when we return.
More of our beef supply is now coming from grain-fed animals, and so it is our supply of lower-grade beef that typically goes into hamburger that is declining most. And so as a result of that, we are seeing relatively more price strength on hamburger and ground beef than we are on some of the other beef cuts.
Competing with the hamburger grinder for these old cows, of course, is every sausage manufacturer, because it has many more superior manufacturing qualities than beef from younger animals when it comes to sausage manufacture. So here we have two competing forces competing for a relatively restricted supply as our cow herds have been built up, and we're sending less of these animals to slaughter than we did several years ago when we were reducing the size of our cow herds substantially.
Caught in a squeeze because of the reduced ground beef supply is the fast food industry, one of our biggest hamburger users.
Well, I guess we all have our challenges, but if there's any one challenge right now in the fast food industry, at primarily the hamburger segment of the fast food industry, it is your beef prices, not just hamburger, but as you know, we have roast beef also. Now, Hardee's is very vertically integrated in that we have our own slaughterhouse, we have our own manufacturing plants, and our own distribution centers, with one distribution center being as close as Mason City, Iowa. So we're very vertically integrated, and we still feel that we have a tremendous challenge. In fact, in the last 12 months, we've had an increase of about 36-37% in beef prices alone. And at the same time, we've only been able to pass along 20% of that in price increases. So this is why I say we have a terrific challenge. Now we see, we really expected prices, today they're at $1.30 a pound from our own company. We really expected about, well, I believe $1.65 at this time. But what we're finding is that the demand is not as great, probably a reaction to the higher prices. So with the demand down a little bit, we're still at $1.30. But we feel it will be at that $1.65, maybe $1.80 by the end of the year.
Workman serves on the National Marketing Advisory Council for the 1,500 Hardee's food systems across the country, and though he cannot speak for them, he expressed some reservations about an all-beef menu.
As I personally think, now these are my views, not necessarily Hardee's food systems, but I really think that we must expand our menu instead of relying so heavily on beef. We have just added the hot ham and cheese. We've gone into salad bars, for example. And I think Hardee's has made a commitment to position itself somewhere between what we call the fast food hamburger restaurant and a full menu restaurant.
I think that if we reduce the supply of beef enough, that we will begin to have another surge in growth of the extender. And technically and nutritionally, it's possible to mix the soybean extender with beef for hamburger and have a perfectly palatable product. I would not be surprised if one of the fast food chains would come out one of these days with, for 30 cents off, you can have the mixed hamburger soybean product. It will be interesting to see what the consumer response might be.
Well, it certainly is not happening now, and I guess with the opportunity I have of sitting on Hardee's National Board, there's certainly nothing even going on in our research department. There was tests done by other companies, and some in the Midwest, as you probably know, recently, I say recently, the last few years, and public acceptance was not there for soy, even as nutritious as it is, and it just isn't there. We are strictly 100% beef, and most of the major chains are.
Families where incomes have not kept pace with the swell of inflation could also be feeling the effect of higher hamburger prices. But Susie Utoff, Extension Home Economist in charge of a four-county expanded nutrition program, says this is not showing up on their checkup sheets on families with limited resources.
Yeah, I have not seen on the servings that come in any droppage. It seems that meat is still being consumed in adequate amounts. For some reason, they always seem to get their two or more servings of meat, and quite often it is the or more situation.
Minnie Jackson, Extension Aide, says the families still like hamburger because they can stretch it.
We do hear a few complaints about this, but they do buy the hamburgers because this is one food that they can stretch. You know, some of our meats we can't stretch, but hamburger can be stretched. They can take a pound of hamburger and serve a large family. Well, what they're doing is they're just eating less meat, putting less meat into their casseroles, their chili, you know, this type of thing. But just they're putting up maybe a pound what it costs for, you know, a pound and a half or 2 pounds, you see. So this is the way they're using basically the other same items that they used before, but they're just using less meat. We're kind of getting away from those hamburger patties right now, and this is because the cost is so high.
But Phyllis Olson, extension nutritionist, says ground beef patties can be extended too.
With non-fat dry milk, with oatmeal, with egg, and with cheese. All of these contain protein. And so then, by extending this 1 pound of beef, instead of getting 4 ground beef patties, we can get 6 meat patties, and they cost less.
Protein, of course, is a nutrient that we all need in our diet, and we think of meat when we think of protein.
Well, all 4 food groups contain some protein, but in different amounts, and they're in less concentrated form than the protein that we find in meat or in animal protein. The recommendations for protein, the U.S. recommended daily allowances are 45 grams per day. And in order to get that amount, if we got all of the protein from ground beef, it would take about 2 1/4 hamburger patties to give us that amount of protein. If we got it in the form of eggs, it would take almost 8 eggs. If we got it in the form of cooked beans, it would be a little over 3 cups of cooked dry beans. If we got it in the form of milk, it would be over 5 cups of milk. And if it were in whole wheat bread, it would be 17 slices or a little bit more, and about 15 potatoes. Ground beef is a concentrated source of protein, but we do get our protein from a mixture of foods. For the equivalent amount of protein that we would find in 2 ounces of cooked ground beef, of course, it would cost 25 cents. Then we go down the list and we find that processed cheese, 2 1-ounce slices of that would cost 23 cents. Cottage cheese, 1/2 cup of that, 22 cents. Pork and beans that have been canned, 1 cup of those cost 16 cents. 2 eggs, 13 cents. 11 cents for 1/4 cup or 4 tablespoons of peanut butter. 7 cents for 1 cup of cooked dry beans. And so you can see there that the lowest cost source of protein is cooked dry beans.
Other ideas?
Well, I think we just need to look to see what the consumer is already doing. Some that enjoy beef are trying to economize with other foods. I think we use extenders day after day just to provide variety in our meals, even though sometimes we think we would like to eat a steak every day. I think many of us would get tired of that. So we do get variety through the kinds of things that we combine with beef. We get from pastas, we get lasagna, goulash, stroganoff, all these kinds of dishes that help to extend that beef. And then we can extend beef in casseroles with rice, with cornmeal, in tamale pie, for example, with oatmeal in meatloaves. So you see, it does help to give us the variety. And people do this without even thinking that they're saving money, but they really are. Another way is that they're looking at the specials that they see on that page that's of advertised specials. And then they're buying these in quantity and are putting them in the freezer.
And when you look in the paper and see one store has a newspaper ad that says chicken is like 39 a pound or 49 a pound, then they buy several of them, you know. And peanut butter. Children always love peanut butter. And so they're using a lot of this peanut butter sandwiches, you know. Sometimes children rather have the peanut butter than the meat.
Another way to cut food costs is to cut down on what nutritionists call low nutrient density foods.
If we have a low nutrient density food, it means that we have a lot of calories but few nutrients. That means that we'd have little protein, little carbohydrate, few vitamins and few minerals.
And how is beef rated in nutrient density?
I do think that beef, of course, is best known for its high-quality protein. And if it's good lean beef, we're going to have more nutrients for the calories, and that means a higher density or higher nutrient density food. And of course, all red meats are well known for their iron, and it's in a form that's more readily utilized and absorbed than iron from plant sources of iron. So I think this is one of the great things about beef and about other red meats as far as that's concerned. Beef also contains appreciable amounts of B vitamins. Beef is a good source of protein, of course, but there are other sources of animal protein that are good too. And this includes, of course, pork and poultry, turkey, chicken, lamb, veal, fish. These are all good sources of protein.
You could easily have someone on this program who would take an opposite position from what I'm going to say. I was somewhat the spokesman years ago for the continued expansion in beef and beef production. I think we've reached I think we're tapering off. The beef animal is essentially inefficient. The beef cow is so non-productive, less than one progeny per year. The beef animal, with its four stomachs, is basically geared to use cheap forage. As a friend of mine says, we keep forgetting that the beef steer is not a hog, and we try to feed the steer as though it were a hog. The steer can't compete with the hog for converting corn, but it certainly can compete with any other animal, except maybe the sheep or goat, in competing roughage. But roughage is scarce. We have less and less open range. We have less and less really cheap pasture land. Every time the price of land goes up, you create an economic pressure to intensify to raise your corn and soybeans and broilers and hogs and so on, and even milk for that matter, and creating an impediment to the forage animal. So I rather think that we are not going to have a continued uptrend in production of beef, which is one reason I think we will use the extender. But I think this is a good question for the longer run future, and I'm slightly pessimistic.
Oh, I think we'll stick with dry lot feeding here because we've got the grain and we've got the roughages that, like silage from where we can use the whole corn plant. And so I think we'll stick with that. And I think that the people are always demand a certain amount of grain-fed beef.
And it is the people, the consumers, who decide for themselves what they want to eat. And if it's beef, to have the money for it, then perhaps we need to look at some of our food buying habits.
First of all, do some planning before they get to the supermarket. I see too many people without lists, simply deciding what they're going to have for the evening meal within that supermarket. And I say if you can plan ahead of time, that eliminates some of the impulse buys. I think the second thing is to try to get the most nutrition for the dollar spent. Too often, I think they just go in and buy what they like. And we really need to think in terms of nutrition that we're getting from those dollars. I guess the third concern is you may have to forego some of those convenient products and do some things from scratch. Anytime you buy maid services, you pay for them. And if we're really trying to cut down some of the dollars in the supermarket, then we bet we're going to have to do some of those things ourselves. The other one is you better understand some of the specials and some of the lures and gimmicks used in grocery stores to get you to buy. We suggest that you use a list, you keep the cart moving, and you get in and get out of that store as soon as possible. The longer you stay, the more you're going to spend.